Hi again, it's Jason from Fraser Valley Rose Farm, and I wonder if you ever considered hybridizing your own rose. It's a selective cross-pollination has been done for centuries by humans, and basically it's just taking the pollen from one plant, moving it over to the flower of another, and then ending up with ripe fruit like these are rose hips, that contain seeds with a unique genetic combination in them that only you have ever seen. Not every one of them will be special, but I think it's a pretty interesting hobby. Now, lots of science can go into the modern art of hybridization, but on the amateur level, you don't need to get that complex, and I bet you I can teach you how to do it within about 5 minutes of lessons here, starting with a quick look at rose biology itself, and then four basic steps that it takes to get going with hybridization. Well, I can't go much further into this topic without talking about sex a little bit. Happily, it is only plant sex, so I don't think I'll pull out any kind of content violations from YouTube. This is Robusta, a flower that is so wide open that you'll be able to easily see the difference between the male parts and the female parts. The male parts are in this ring around the outside. I'm going to get you a close up here. There are sort of filaments with a pollen sac on the top. That's where you get the male pollen from the flower. In the center, however, you're going to see a different part. That's the landing pad. It's called the stigma, and it's the top of the female part of the rose. It accepts the pollen and then carries that genetic material down to the ovary of the rose to develop the seeds. Now, roses, of course, have pollen and the female parts, the male and female parts of their flower, on the same flower. That's just the way they roll. And if you look at it wide open like this, actually, you're a little bit too late to the party. The pollen is already ready to release, the stigma is already ready to accept that pollen, and the flower is wide open. So as far as you know, a bee could already have visited that flower. So you need to get to it a little bit sooner. Let me show you the stage you need to collect it at here, and we'll go into the first step, which is collecting the pollen. Step one, collecting the pollen, and you can see that this one here is already too wide open. The bees can get in there and contaminate that flower already. So what we're looking for are roses more along the stage of the ones on the left here that are well-developed and opening, but not quite wide open enough for bees to get in there with. So let me show you how to deal with those. At this stage of opening, the pollen may not be quite ready to release, but that's why you're grabbing it now, putting it into a little glass bowl like this. I just stole mine from upstairs, don't tell Lisa. And what you do is you strip off the petals. Now you can strip it off by hand like this, just being careful not to disturb the central pollen sacs. Or you can pull out a little pair of trimming shears like this and then just cut them around from the outside edges. So what you're left with is just this central thing here, the central flower with all of the pollen sacs intact. And I'm going to do the same thing to the other one here. So once I've collected a number of these flowers for pollen of the same variety into this dish, I can put them into a cool, dry place, and usually I wait about a day. And by that point, if you give them a little tap like this, you'll see the little grains of pollen dropping off into the bottom of the bowl. Some people will actually remove the pollen sacs entirely and collect a whole big batch of pollen. I think on an amateur level, the guy who taught me how to do it said, just leave it on this, it's easier. And then you can use this as a little brush to put the pollen onto the female. Step two, preparing the female flower, is just about the same as preparing the male flower with two small differences. One difference is that you need to leave the flower on the plant. If you want the seed hips to ripen, you need to leave it on the plant so it could be supplied with energy and ripen over the course of the next 2 or 3 or 4 months into the fall. The second thing that you're going to do, this part is the same, you need to remove those petals. I'll do that part right here. But there's one additional step you have to do after you've removed the petals. And this step is called emasculation. I'm going to go around the outside edge and just pull off all of that immature pollen, trying not to contaminate things as I go. Don't think that it's quite ready to release now anyway, but it is nice to get it off of there. Now, the question that some people may have is, now that I've pulled off those petals and left this female part all exposed like that, isn't there a chance that the bees come and pollinate that? And the answer is that the bees aren't very interested in these flowers once you've removed the petals. So this is a female flower currently with all the male parts removed, but the bees have no interest in it. Step three is a little bit time sensitive. This is when you're actually transferring the pollen from the flowers you collected to this female flower. So timeline here might be important. Day one, let's say that's when you removed your male flowers and collected the pollen. Let's say in the morning of day two, you emasculated this female flower. Then later that same day, you may come, if the pollen is ready, and then just dab the pollen onto that stigma. Now, here's the thing, you don't know that that stigma is ready. If you looked at it very closely with a magnifying glass, you might see it change from being kind of dry to being a little bit sticky. Now, the pollen, same thing, you'll notice from the bottom of the bowl whether the pollen is starting to release. So if you don't know, the safe thing is to continue to retry this. So if you tried, again, day one you collected the pollen, day two you emasculated the female flower, later that same day you tried to put the pollen on, I would go back the following day and maybe even 2 days later and tap that pollen on again. And by then you should be fairly sure that both the pollen and the female part, that stigma, were ready and receptive to go ahead with the process. And very careful at this stage, very important at this stage, to go ahead and label this stem with a strip label of what is the male, what is the pollen contributor. You probably know what the female is because that's the plant, but the male contribution, you're going to have to label that one there.
While steps 1, 2, and 3 are all relatively quick and time sensitive, they can happen within a few days, and that pollen is only good for about 3 or 4 days anyway. The stage 4 is actually characterized by a lot of waiting around. What you'll see is that where that flower was starts to ripen into the receptacle, starts to swell, and it becomes the fruit of the rose, progressively over time becoming larger, rounder, and eventually taking on a blush of orange. That can happen over the course of 3 or 4 months. And so you can time back in your own climate and figure out, well, when do I have to start this cross? And for most winter climates where you get a winter, you're going to say that this should happen sometime early in the flowering season, not late summer or fall, because you may not have time to ripen those seeds. Now, I've done a whole video on how to stratify the seeds. So that's basically step four, and I'm going to refer you to that video. But what it means is that once those seeds are, that seed pod is ripe, you remove the seeds from that, and then you start on the process of stratification, giving those seeds a cold treatment. Usually I do that in sand or vermiculite, mix it in, put it in the fridge for, again, another 3 months or so, and then by January or February, I'm ready to take those out, put them into a seed tray, and try to germinate them. Well, I said I could do this in 5 minutes. I might be pretty close on the instructional portion of this, but I do have a couple of final pieces of advice to throw in at the back end of the video here. Number one, don't be afraid to start right now. And by start right now in the fall in the Northern Hemisphere, means you don't have time to start the hybrids. But what you could do is you could start collecting ripe hips from known good roses around your garden and work on the germination techniques. And actually, those are open pollinated, so they all have unique genetics within them, and that'll give you a chance to try out starting seedlings and selecting seedlings. And frankly, I was talking to Robin at the Brentwood Bay Nursery, and he introduced a number of roses from exactly this, just collecting ripe hips off of known good mother plants where you don't know where the pollen came from, and nature did its thing, and he still ended up with some exceptional roses out of that program. Second thing I wanted to say is this can be very complex, and there's lots of information out there. So one place you can go for good information on this, I'll link below, is the Rose Hybridizers Forum, where they talk about all the genetic foibles of mothers and fathers, what makes a good pollen parent, what makes a good seed parent, which ones are genetically compatible, all of that stuff. So it's the kind of hobby or the part of the hobby where you can choose to know as little or as much as you want to. And if you want to do just little, just try a lot out there, move a lot of pollen from a lot of plants to other plants and see what takes, and then you'll figure out what works for yourself. But if you want to take a more scientific approach and share your information with other hybridizers, that forum is out there for you. Okay, thanks so much for watching today, and if you have any questions, please drop those down in the comments below the video. I'll see what I can do to help.